Welcome back. It's time to talk with our panel about this week's top stories. Joining us today, Republican strategist Jennifer Hollowell, Democratic strategist Laura Beck, and Abdul Hakim Shabazz, a editor and publisher of IndyPolitics.org, as well as Dr. Wilson, a political science professor at the University of Indianapolis. So we are just 2 days away here from Super Tuesday, but a big talker today, and really throughout the week, has been about the coronavirus and the response as well. A lot of scrutiny this week for Vice President Mike Pence. You heard the House Speaker say and bring up his HIV outbreak response then in 2014. Is he the right person for the job?
I think so, and here's why. Some people give the vice president criticism for his performance during the HIV outbreak. I mean, it was something Indiana had never had before. I think it's fair to say that they learned a lot and actually did a pretty decent job at containing everything once they got the wheels in motion. So at the very least, the vice president knows what works, what doesn't work, and kind of coordinate the team.
Well, he knows what doesn't work is to wait. So, I mean, he did learn that from the experience. I actually felt a little sorry for him because the way Donald Trump, President Trump, teed it up, it wasn't like this resounding sort of endorsement of what a great job he's going to do. And so I feel like it's putting him in kind of a tough spot, because if this thing really takes off like it's expected, you're in a no-win situation.
Politically, probably that's true. I agree with one of the things that Abdul said. He's gone through this experience before, and to your point, he knows not to wait. That's really important. It's always, I think, valuable to mention HIV outbreak is not the same thing as coronavirus and things like that. It's certainly difficult, but also legally, the vice president doesn't get a whole lot of things to do. So this is something that he can work on, and if he has an opportunity, wants to run for president in the future, if it's a success, it could be something he can use.
And when you look back, there have been a handful of times over the past 3 years where the president has tapped the vice president to lead on certain efforts. He certainly led on the effort for the United States-Mexico-Canada deal, which was a very, you know, difficult thing to get passed and got bipartisan support. He's led on a couple of different issues, the peace agreement between Turkey and Syria. He was instrumental in. So I think it makes a lot of sense. And he's going to convene all these experts. Some Hoosier leaders are among them, health experts. And I think that it will be a very thoughtful approach.
Well, we know that he's obviously been tapped for this position. There's also the question of who's really in charge here, because we also know the Health and Human Services Secretary Alex Azar is a part of this, and then the vice president tapped Dr. Deborah Birx as part of this as well. Do you think he's really going to be the one calling the shots?
I don't know. At this point in time, I hate to say this, but I really don't care who's calling the shots. I think what we need is we need to have a thoughtful solution that actually really addresses what is becoming a global pandemic and is really impacting not just the national economy, but it has far-reaching repercussions. So I think as many people who are involved and as many people who have a seat at the table and as many people who can act really makes the most important piece. Whether he's the right person to convene that, I think that reasonable minds can disagree, but it's critically important we act and we act now.
But one thing to keep in mind is, and with the coronavirus and, you know, all the other outbreaks we had, whether it was Ebola or West Nile virus, you know, back in 2001, 2002, you know, we shouldn't start getting into, you know, the sort of the panic mode. One of my favorite internet memes has been, you know, keep calm and wash your hands. You know, and just, you know, America, you know, don't say no. It's not the zombie apocalypse. And please note, you know, there are 6 billion people on this planet, maybe what 100,000 that have been infected. So a little perspective, I think, is in order. I think somebody like Mike Pence can actually bring that, you know, to the table.
And the role here is leadership. And so that's why I think this is the right choice. And also, the United States is a lot different than China and other countries in terms of how we are positioned with leaders that he will be able to convene to make those decisions.
One thing we can't ignore that Dr. Wilson brought up is the political ramifications of this appointment, what it could mean in 2024, because we're always looking forward. If this works out, what does that mean for a possible run for the vice president? If it doesn't, what does it mean?
Well, I do think it's a collaborative effort, and it needs to be, but it will be something that's tied to him. So if it's positive, then this is great. This is something he could use to that credit. Of course, if it doesn't turn out that way, I think there'd be that concern as well. His reputation could be on the line in this way. Because it's a collaboration, on the plus side, you could always say, well, it was a group effort. But nonetheless, his name will certainly be tied to it.
And if it doesn't work, it'll just be Trump-Haley in 2024 as opposed to Trump-Pence.
At least, all right.
That's what the conspiracy theorists say.
Well, let's keep talking about the campaign trail here, because the vice president was on the campaign trail in recent days. Back in the Midwest, he spent time in Michigan, where he caught up with our affiliate in Lansing with some harsh words for Democrats and specifically the Sanders campaign. Take a listen.
Well, certainly, it certainly looks like Bernie Sanders is the front runner. But we'll see more as South Carolina Super Tuesday unfolds. But, you know, the reality is, whether it's Bernie Sanders who openly advocates socialism or all the other candidates who embrace the same policies, calling them Medicare for All or the Green New Deal, higher taxes, open borders, we relish the opportunity to have that debate.
Senator Sanders was front and center at the Democratic debate in South Carolina this past week. It was the last debate before Super Tuesday with former VP Joe Biden hoping for more momentum heading into next week.
Bernie and I agree on a lot of things, but I think I would make a better president.
Bernie, in fact, hasn't passed much of anything.
Imagine spending the better part of 2020 with Bernie Sanders versus Donald Trump.
I'm hearing my name mentioned a little bit tonight.
A lot of it. So that was the last debate before Super Tuesday. What did you see maybe in that debate that could possibly push either of these candidates forward as we look into these primaries, 14 states on Tuesday?
Well, Joe Biden has a pulse, so I was kind of wondering where that was, you know, in the last couple of days. But I do think, and this kind of goes back to our conversation we had earlier about the coronavirus. When things get uncertain, one of the things that voters look for is some kind of certainty. And I'm not sure, you know, but someone like a Bernie Sanders, who I think the Democrats are right, you know, when you look at his record, you know, what have you done? What have you accomplished? You know, it's like a movie where the best parts are the trailers. Then you get to the movie theater, it's like, well, I can't believe I spent $15 on this. And so I think for the challenge for Bernie Sanders is going to be, you know, when in troubled times and uncertainty, are you the person the Democrats can pick to lead? If they pick an avowed socialist, this is going to be like a Walter Mondale, George McGovern beating that the Democrats will get in 2020.
I think that when we go back to the debate, I don't think that debate was really the best the best format. I mean, I think that was one of probably the worst debates I've ever seen. Now, I mean, you can't say anything because you've got Donald Trump, so we've seen a lot of your debates over the years. But it was such a horrible debate, and it really did not shine anyone in a positive light, and I think it was really just poorly done. That said, what I think is really going to ultimately drive a lot of this moving into Super Tuesday is money. And then past Super Tuesday, who's going to have the money to compete beyond Super Tuesday? And there are going to be some tough decisions that a lot of these candidates are going to have to put aside their ego and figure out how they're going to coalesce around a nominee.
I'm just talking about
some of the other candidates up there who, if your campaign is on life support because you're running out of money, it's just not going to magically fall from the sky. And you've got to have money to compete, and whether they like it or not, Bloomberg is in the race, and it's changing the dynamic in a really unprecedented way.
And that's what I was going to mention here, because you mentioned money and fundraising is certainly not a problem for him. $500 million spent on advertisement, the first time we will see his name on the ballot. Could he shake things up here?
Yes. I mean, he's already running in my home state of Illinois. Their primary is until March 17th. He's already running, you know, television radio commercials in Illinois, and it's still, you know, 6 weeks away. So I could easily see, unless we have just a little meltdown, Mr. Bloomberg stay in the distance.
Yeah. Well, and he's really important ideologically because you have Warren and Sanders on the far left, and then you have everybody else in this middle cutting away at those. I think he does chip away at it, and the fact that he's chipping away at one point, there's a lot of other candidates there. It's going to make a big impact on Klobuchar, on Buttigieg, on Biden, on all those middle candidates who are trying to get that middle ground.
They're fighting for a piece of the pie.
Bloomberg's performance in this debate was a little bit better than the last one, but still, all of the money that he's been spending is kind of eaten away at in his debate performances because they're not very strong, and I think that's hurting him. And to me, it just looked like Bernie's starting to run away with this. And so if you look at Texas and California and some of these other Super Tuesday states where he right now is polling in the lead, if that is the case, he'll be unstoppable.
A lot more to talk about here, but coming up next, the mayor of Indianapolis taking on apartment landlords and state lawmakers over the issue of renters' rights. We will explain coming up next.